Hit that subscribe button and make way, because the salt must flow.
One of the videos I've worked hardest on, and it's certainly my longest video, is the Thomas Sowell video, which is all well and good. I'm glad I did it. It's pretty good. I don't really see other people approaching the particular discrepancies in his writing too much, and it's something that has to be done because, as I exhibited there, there are major problems. Half-truths, half-lies, things that just didn't work out in the way that he assumes that they kind of worked out in that way. So that's an issue because it's very counterproductive for us to believe in false things or things that really work against us in some way or another that we may not be looking at. But to my surprise, even with all the analysis I put into that, when I revisit, I find that some people are still struggling with recognizing how insanely stupid one of the central points was of the Thomas Sowell book. And I think what I just said there, that was specifically meant to be harder than I went in terms of the video itself, because I think that in the original video, I didn't really say how stupid the central thesis was. You know, I started the video out displaying how, just from an instinct, Jordan Peterson was able to figure out that, yeah, this thesis is probably wrong, but even there, he's still able to recognize that Sowell's central thesis, the one that he's been parading around for all these years, is, yeah, not correct. It's wrong. It's just plain out and completely wrong. But I don't think necessarily everyone really recognizes how wrong it is. So I just want to put out this short video to express the depths of wrongness and to visually tell you why the central thesis is wrong, this idea that Sowell has that somehow modern black culture, including modern urban culture, modern southern culture, all this comes from the rednecks and the crackers, these kind of people. Now, this description that Sowell offers us of these people is specifically backwoods people, and he cites the pages. So I can go to the source here and describe these people, their settling patterns, and how they moved around, how they lived, and we might find that they're like Sowell described to some extent, but the history is clear that this is not the population that was closest and most interacting with the black population that Sowell is describing. So let me read you a little bit of descriptions that are referenced from Albion Seed so that we know exactly which people we're talking about. Right here. Crackers, rednecks, Hoosiers, words that described the largest social class in the American backcountry, were not coined in the New World. They were carried out of North Britain. For three centuries, these terms were variously used as praise words and pejoratives, according to context and occasion, but always they describe the same paradox of poverty and pride. Certainly, woe, something of that spirit was captured by the American painter Frederick Remington in a sketch from which this drawing is taken. The name Hoosier was often applied to these backwoodsmen, even as far south as northern Louisiana and southern Arkansas. Everywhere the general characteristics of this tribe were the same, east to Georgia and from Mississippi and Alabama, north to Illinois and Indiana. So first, knowing it's always backwoodsmen, that's what we're describing. That's what Sowell's describing. It's a particular type of person. So we're not even necessarily talking about one particular region. We're talking about people who had a particular characteristic, and that characteristic includes being poor, aka people who were not slave owners. They're not described as slave owners. Anyways, the word Hoosier comes from Hoosier or Hoosier in the Old Cumberland dialect, which means something or someone who was unusually large and rough. In W.J. Cash's phrase, a hell of a fellow. After coming to America in the 18th century, the noun migrated north to Indiana with so much of the backcountry culture. and was attached to the citizens of that state to distinguish them from their Yankee neighbors. Another term for this rural proletariat was redneck, which was originally applied to the back settlers because of their religion. The earliest American example known to this historian was recorded in North Carolina by Anne Royal in 1830, who noted that redneck was a name bestowed upon the Presbyterians. It had long been a slang word for religious dissenters in the north of England. A third word for this rural proletariat, which also came from Britain, was cracker, which derived from an English pejorative for a low and vulgar braggart. In 1766, an informant wrote the Earl of Dartmouth about the American backcountry, "I should explain, your lordship, what is meant by cracker, a name they have got from being great boasters. They are lawless set of rascals on the frontiers of Virginia, Maryland, the Carolinas, and Georgia, who often change their adobe." This distinctive backcountry underclass was in being by the mid-18th century. Its call names had originated in North Britain, so also had its character and culture, which still survive today. So, also noting here, their locations are on the borders, the frontiers. So, they're not in the well-established rural areas that we're describing these types of people, the types of people that Sowell is using as an example. They're not in the main areas that would become the cities of the South. They're not close to the East Coast. And so when we're looking at these population maps and we're seeing the areas that are the highest density of slavery, the most slaves per square mile, this is exactly where these backcountry people were not. And you can sort of notice this trend as it continues in time, because we're mostly talking in this case with examples from the older period, long before the Civil War, where you're really seeing that the slavery is concentrated on that East Coast. But as it progresses, one thing that is consistent is that the frontier, you don't have as many slaves in these areas. So a very small percentage of the enslaved population would have necessarily interacted with this kind of people. And to further express this, let's read some more from Albion Seeds. The Backcountry Committee. Patterns of Migration, Settlement, and Association. The borderers were a restless people who carried their migratory ways from Britain to America. There had been many folk movements in their history before the Atlantic crossing, and many more were yet to come. The history of these people was a long series of removals, from England to Scotland, from Scotland to Ireland, from Ireland to Pennsylvania, from Pennsylvania to Carolina, from Carolina to the Mississippi Valley, from the Mississippi to Texas, from Texas to California, and from California to the Rainbow's End. Rates of geographic migration were very high in this culture in Britain. Some of the highest rates of rural migration were to be found on the northern borders. The Scottish village of Fintray, for example, had a turnover of 75% in 5 years, a rate much above the parishes of southern England. Similar patterns also appeared in the American backcountry, where rates of internal migration were also higher than in the rural communities of New England, the Delaware and Tidewater Virginia. In backcountry Lunenburg County, Virginia, for example, one historian found what he called phenomenal movement of the population from 1750 to 1769. 80% of the population disappeared from the country. 40% did so in 5 years from 1764 to 1769. These rates of movement were exceptional by 18th century standards. The back settlers thought about moving in a way that was different from more sedentary people. There was a folk saying in the Southern Highlands, "When I get ready to move, I just shut the door, call the dogs, and start." This was the footloose way in which Andrew Jackson was said to have come into the backcountry with nothing but two riding horses, a gun at his side, and a pack of hunting dogs at his heel. So, on Andrew Jackson, there you go. There you have an example of someone who you can describe as having cracker characteristics, who actually, we know, owned slaves, interacted with slaves. So you would think that there you go, there you finally have a good example. But the problem of this is Andrew Jackson really stood out And let's then go over why he stood out. Andrew Jackson, born right here in Waxhaws. And I don't have the map census for his birth year, so this is the closest to what we're seeing here with the 1 to 5 slaves per mile squared. Still relatively low, though, compared to more of the East Coast, and that's still 23 years after Jackson was born. Just compare it there to the amount of slavery you had in New York at that time. So this level of slavery in that area was growing in the Waxhaws as he grew up, but by 1790, he wasn't even in that area. So yes, though, his ancestry matches the described cracker ancestry, and they lived in this area, but moved around, of course, like a cracker, as we would expect. His family were Presbyterian, and they were from Ulster, Ireland. And this will be important because Jackson ascended economically. He changed his location, and what we see in his history is that he stood out from a lot of the other wealthy people he interacted with. And that includes that he stood out from the other slave owners and the general white southern community that he lived around. I'll give you examples of that as his life continued. So, 1784, he moved very slightly north to Salisbury, North Carolina, and he did that studying as a young lawyer. As you see here, that meant that as he proved his intelligence and other lawyer-related skills enough that he was ascending economically at that time, there was a bit more slavery in that new area. And so as Jackson gained money in that area, which per description we've read was unusual for crackers, this is useful in pointing out that it was possible for such people to gain wealth. You know, there wasn't an explicit anti-Irish bias that's completely stopped them from gaining access to this if they could prove themselves in one way or another, or had the right connections, though Jackson himself wasn't born particularly wealthy. So with his lawyer money, though, he moved out here to Gallatin, Tennessee, and you'll see he was moving out to that particular part of Tennessee because it was building up plantations, and that's what he did. So yes, we have an example of a cracker who interacted with black people and a lot of black people, but again, he stood out there. His marriage to a divorcee was taken as scandalous, and it led to a duel with Charles Dickinson, where apparently Jackson decided to let Dickinson take the first shot, which Dickinson did, hitting Jackson in the chest. But as that was part of the plan, Jackson took his time and his aim and survived the bullet wound and shot Dickinson to death, as the duel required standing still, no dodging allowed. But this was an unusual strategy, and actually it outraged the people of Tennessee, his neighbors, which made him an outcast for a time. This is one of the many examples of something I would like to term the exception defines the rule in reverse. Note here, the description of even more brutal duels within full cracker communities within Albion Seeds were greeted with celebration when those duels happened. They declared people like Jackson heroes. But as exhibited here, where Jackson's duel strategy stood out, the southern whites in plantation areas reacted very negatively. So even though Jackson was ancestrally a cracker with certain characteristics that match, he kept standing out, because he was absolutely not the typical kind of person that owned slaves, and absolutely not your typical kind of person that lived in the more established plantation areas. And even note what's going on with the spread of these denser plantation areas. You can match some of the developing densities to modern urban areas. That's what happened. So we shouldn't think of the plantation areas of the past as equivalent to the rural areas of the present, which these present areas away from the cities are more where modern versions of rednecks and modern farmers live. Again, you have these more mobile people that, you know, are consistently on the border, per the description. And you can see here, as Jackson bought more slaves and built up his plantation alongside other people doing the same, and you got up to this 5 to 10 enslaved per mile squared, that these areas are gaining density in that sense. And the county directly below that with the 10 to 20 enslaved per mile squared became modern Nashville. So anyways, that sums up why Jackson stood out, that it was possible for crackers to ascend economically and get involved in growing slavery areas, which would become more urban eventually, but that was the less common thing, and that Jackson stood out, even becoming a standout cracker president, expresses that this was, again, not the typical culture of the plantation owners and people in their areas. So anyways, here's just a political cartoon of Andrew Jackson destroying the Devil Bank. Based. Most geographic migration in both the British borderlands and the American backcountry consisted of short distance movements that were covered only a few miles, as families searched for slightly better living conditions. Frequent removals were encouraged by low levels of property owning and by characteristic attitudes toward wealth and land and work in this culture. During the first few years of settlement, backcountry folk settled close to one another for mutual protection. The result was the planting of stations in Tennessee and forts in Kentucky. But as the backcountry gradually became more secure, another pattern appeared, one that was very different from the committees of Massachusetts, Virginia, and Pennsylvania. The backcountry ideal was a scattered settlement pattern in isolated farmsteads, loosely grouping in sprawling neighborhoods that covered many miles. The German traveler Schopf in 1784 observed that in North Carolina, the farms were scattered about in these woods at various distances, 3 to 6 miles, and often as much as 10 or 15 or 20 miles apart. North Carolina Congressman Nathaniel Macon startled his Yankee colleagues by arguing that no man ought to live so near another as to hear his neighbor's dog bark. That attitude was widely shared in the backcountry. In this culture, a house became a hermitage, beyond sight and sound of every human habitation. Once again, Andrew Jackson personified his culture. Jackson's home in Tennessee was actually called the Hermitage. When he was away from it, he wrote home to his wife expressing his longing for sweet retirement apart from other people. There were, of course, physical limits to the realization of this idea, but the idea itself became an important reality in the culture of the backcountry. It persisted for many generations in the isolated homes that were built in the hollows of Appalachia, the cane brakes of Kentucky, the flatlands of Texas, and the ravines of Southern California. Now, first, we can note that these are very mobile people. They settled in areas that weren't necessarily the most agricultural, but they settled with areas where they had enough land to work with, and they'd be on the frontier, and they'd constantly be on the frontier too. They could keep moving, and they could move out further and further, and this follows some of the general description of how these people would not be building up an area that would become a major metropolitan. It wouldn't become particularly dense, so you wouldn't have as high of a population. It's just about being on the border, being free. And we can also note from these descriptions the Appalachians, the cane brakes of Kentucky, the flatlands of Texas. We know exactly then where these people being described are. And you can sort of connect this together to modern day. That these descriptions then mean that these would be West Virginias on the Appalachians. And if we look at our map, no slavery, certainly not much slavery. There's not many black people interacting there to this day. How about that portion of Texas? Nope. Yeah, so these people, we know their locations, and we know that these locations remained separate from these interactions with the black people at the time. And if we overlay a map of the cash crops, we can tell why it was that the larger plantations were placed where they were and why those were the areas where larger, more urban areas started to pop up in relation to these cash crops and to greater populations, all this population concentration, and that's where you'd have a far, far larger percentage of the slaves. So there's your interaction. And just think about it. Think about it in terms here. I'm telling you that these are the backcountry people who are poor, they're mobile, they don't own too much, they're on the border, and their interactions are defensive interactions, mainly against the Amerindians of the area. That's also why it was appreciated that they were out there. So in modern day, when we're talking about poor rednecks, we're talking about poor rednecks still. So back then, you know, these people did not have the money or the interest to have much slave ownership, to have that sort of interaction. And so when Sowell cites these specific people and says that this culture is then connected, it is given to modern day black people through the interactions, we can say very confidently that these are the exact kind of people that did not really have too many of those interactions, relatively speaking. Very, very few from the maps as we're seeing. What Sowell is doing is actually quite obnoxious because it's the same as the modern day anti-white narrative that so much targets the poor whites of America. Let's face it, the poor whites, people who might have more instinctual responses to other races, who might have less of a over-socialized filter in terms of their thinking and in terms of their communication, these people, if you go back in time, might be the lower IQ people. But within the anti-white narrative that is perpetuated by such anti-white oligarchs, these are the people who are public enemy number one. These are the people who need to have their lives further ruined, you know, even if they're probably pretty poor, and many generations back, their family's probably pretty poor. But their family did so much to ensure the safety, the national border, and the well-being of this entire nation. Just think about that. If we dive back in, if we do this thought experiment and think about what would be the realistic people who interacted with a far larger percentage of the slaves during that time period, who would they be? First, we have Richard Steckel's A Peculiar Population, The Nutrition, Health, and Mortality of American Slaves from Childhood to Maturity, where he compared the height of average slaves to the larger population and found their height to be variable by location, but overall a good deal taller than most. The only taller exceptions in the white population being Swedes and English aristocrats. Now, this is compared to the modern measurements of everyone in America today, which for modern times finds that black people here are about the same height as white people and a little bit shorter, actually, on average. Okay, so outside of genetics then, the biggest factor to height is nutrition. Disease also has an effect, but a relatively small one. So if we're saying that the slave population and then the freed population had plenty of health overall relative to the white population, that should tell you something pretty interesting. And in before, there are other explanations. While life expectancy was shorter, it's not all that different from modern differences in life expectation. Overall, it's a similar trend. What I would say instead is that something is going on with nutrition, diets, all of this stuff, which has now in modern times kept white people taller and black people very slightly shorter. So anyways, how about the literacy for this time? Well, from the 1870 census, 20.1% of blacks could read and write compared to 80% of US whites. And that actually shows some separation between the backwoods people, the crackers that Sowell is referring to, and the education that black people had. Now, a lot of Sowell's stories compare these populations in the 1700s and early 1800s, not so much the time of the Civil War or soon after. So likely the literacy rate of Southerners in general was consistently lower than Northerners, as this census does indicate. But also, it's possible that in past generations, the literacy rate was lower for backwoodsmen compared to the plantation South. However, by 1870, the literacy rate for the areas, the cracker areas, West Virginia, Appalachia, portions of Kentucky, and heading out west to Texas, these areas were pretty middle of the road in literacy, actually. The dominant areas of illiteracy match up very well with cash crop locations and enslaved locations, which, if you track race by race numerically, you will see. But simply enough, you have the map here indicating a highly literate, educated collection of people in the North, New Hampshire, Vermont, and while this census did not cover all the borderers, for those that stayed in territories like Appalachia, they weren't all that illiterate compared to other white men of the South, except, of course, the wealthy Southerners. And that just is an indication that as time went on, Thomas Sowell's description of these people is again wrong. But it still wouldn't matter anyways, because he keeps referencing crackers, backwoods people. And the maps keep telling us that during slavery and for the time soon after slavery, these were exactly not the kind of white Southerners that black people were interacting with. He just keeps selecting anecdotes about the precisely wrong white Southern people. Now, also a typical context to express what this illiteracy rate really meant in all practicality is that the overall country rate of literacy, and even this 20% black literacy rate, was above a large portion of the world. In comparison, that same year, the literacy rate of Russia was 15%. Now, back to those slavery interactions. In Sowell's theory, forming the culture prior to the War of Northern Aggression. Well, you have John F. Olson in his analysis of Southern cotton farms and Northern farms, and he came to the conclusion that the average free farmer on a Northern farm worked 3,130 hours per year, while the black slave worked 2,798 hours per year. That slightly surprised me because many sources make a lot of farm work sound limited in seasonal work. And even Sowell admits that the overall value of Northern farm agriculture ended up greater and more useful to industrialization. But he puts it down to largely more clever farming in the North. What's clear here, though, is that the Northern farmers worked incredibly hard. For reference, that's a 60-hour work week for them in the North, and the slaves worked harder than, let's say, your average office worker with their 40-hour work weeks, but at an average 53.8-hour work week for slaves, they worked less than the Northern farmers, less than the over 60-hour work week, which 72% of farmers indicated they work in modern day in a recent poll. And certainly, all of these listed are much less than the 70-hour work week reported for a good portion of child labor during the Industrial Revolution. We are quite certain that the people in the cities under industrialization were working harder than all these people. So, in comparison to all of these, it's possible that the crackers, backwoodsmen, were as lazy as Sowell gets at with his stories. But by their nature, that is a group that I don't believe we have any valid statistics on their work hours. Given their profession described being more minimal farming and hunting for food, less excess production to sell, it seems likely that their hours were less than all these other groups. But that really does depend on them not working the same type of farming jobs as the slaves during that time. And after all, Sowell is arguing that a sense of cultural laziness came from the crackers. And well, even though slaves on farms worked less than many men of the North, what really happened to that 53-hour work week? What happened to that mentality after being freed from slavery? I think we could only guess that it is natural preference, not the cultural influence from slavery days. But let's keep constructing this image of who was interacting with black people during slavery and after slavery. We know about the interaction of the aristocratic few, the wealthy, with the ownership records being 1.4% of the U.S. population. So just the few wealthy and pretty consistently considered best educated people of the South were interacting with slaves, as well as the family of these elites were also interacting. So by relation, these family members were also educated and would be interacting. And in this book, Sowell himself mentions the high percentage of Jewish families which also owned slaves in some areas, though, as always, that did not constitute the majority of slaves. Do not fall for that trap. It's not a statistic certainty, but per Sowell's theory of cultural exchange, it would be more likely that a reasonable percentage of black people came out of slavery after receiving Jewish culture. It's certainly more reasonable than saying the people off in the backwoods shared that culture. But in particular, what I'm pointing out is that the most reasonable description of one kind of contact is the wealthy, literate, well-educated people of the South. That's one point of expected cultural exchange. And also, that 20% of the black people in America were literate by 1870, you can say that reading, that sort of cultural exchange, was more restricted. Certainly it was. But you know, one in five then. That's a fine trajectory within that cultural exchange of education allowed predominantly by the wealthy. It would not be difficult to build off of that as long as that literate trait was considered useful. And in Sowell's anecdotes, it was considered useful for several generations after. And then the next point of cultural contact, and the most consistent one, was other black people. With 53.8-hour work weeks, there is 56 hours for sleeping, and 88.2 hours per week for playing, talking, eating, worshiping, whatever. In actual hours, the majority of cultural life was shared with other people of African descent. And yes, there was some cultural exchange. Sowell gives the example of Christian worship, which we know from records mainly came from the plantation owners and missionaries, definitely not crackers. And he also gives the example of a beloved card game. And we don't know exactly which white group introduced that exactly, but again, we could expect that the cultural exchange came from the owners and family. So what do we really have for the remaining slave era cultural contacts? The next answer, and a different class interaction at least, that we know of would be the white motivator of the gang system. And no, that does not mean whipping, as we can't be sure how common whipping was, but there are few records to indicate that it was not common. And in general, it just does not make any sense to open wounds over nothing, as in those times, open wounds could kill. And I already showed you the low life expectancy across the board for that era. The motivator was a guy who kept labor organized, directed, and led encouragement. But which cultural interactions do we really expect from such workers? Ways of encouraging, no doubt, but black people have long declared spiritual songs used during work as their own reworking of Christian songs. So, was that a white man, actually, leading a gospel choir and teaching them these songs in the field, and that was the cultural exchange? I don't think so. I think that these motivators of the gang system were mainly work organizers, directors, and that's not the cultural exchange during that time unless you assume that the motivation itself was cultural influence. So what do we have left? Maybe water cooler talk. No doubt that did happen in the sense of they took breaks, they were getting water, etc. But still, the cultural exchange there is definitely not a backwoods person by nature. And then we only have contact with other town people who are town people, not backwoods people. And we know from migration patterns and also census records that after the end of slavery, black people didn't all immediately move around. It took time. But then we know even from Sowell's writing that a lot of education interactions came from the New England abolitionists pouring into the South with black exclusive schools to raise that education. So just looking at these maps, we already know that these are people from the most literate, educated portion of America, and they were the ones coming down to spread that culture, and from a Puritan background. They were strict, they placed specific taboos on sexuality, loudness, etc. So where did that culture go, Mr. Sowell? Where did that education and that way of thinking and working go? In answer, and in contrast to Sowell's story of cultural exchange, which points to the people of Appalachia, Texas, these highly mobile people who were poor, who didn't own much, and who didn't own slaves, my theory of cultural exchange is that there was well-recorded interactions with the southern elites, middle class, including informing the black practice of Christianity. And somewhere between there and pretty smart people in the North, you ended up with 20% literacy. And outside of that, you had most of the cultural interactions by hour, by day, being African with African interactions, except for the free persons of color in the North. But that was a relatively small proportion, which acted differently when they were joined by a greater numeric community of black folks later on. And then they largely faded back into the more dominant black community. The other cultural interaction, immediately after slavery, were the well-educated leftists of that day, taking interest in them from day one and trying to impart a very strict culture. The real story of cultural interaction during slavery and for the period immediately after was interactions largely with the educated, the wealthy, the Christian. They were trained to work harder, potentially, than the backwoods men, the hunters. They were trained to work on farms. And they were subjected to all of these cultural interactions and lessons in agriculture. But it all changed pretty quickly, and all you really had over the next couple of decades was the continuation of fervent Christianity. Though it broke off and was in many ways Africanized, as I've looked at. It would seem that when you correct for the people that black people were actually interacting with, a whole lot worked in the exact opposite of what Sowell would predict based on his model of cultural exchange. Because if it had been learned culture, blacks would have turned into strict, hardworking, eloquent people. Sowell himself says they didn't, though. What I see instead, which is a much better description, is a pull of a genetic mesh, and in a single term, a African biospirit. Throughout slavery, this was enforced by constant African interactions, community, and that preference continued and intensified after slavery ended. That return to the African biospirit superseded everything else. And that's exactly why you feel like Europe is Africanized today in some areas. These are not African Americans. No American history, no cracker history, but they act in relation to a biospirit. Absolutely no contact was needed with Appalachia or Texas. No contact, past or present, to rednecks. Sowell is wrong.
Some folks call me a rambling man. I do a lot of thumbing and kicking cans, and it wouldn't do an ounce of good to call my name. 'Cause daddy's name wasn't Willie Woodrow, and I wasn't born and raised in no ghetto. Just a white boy looking for a place to do my thing. Well, I'm out to find me a wealthy woman in a line of work that don't take no diploma. I ain't got much to lose, but got a lot to gain. Here some might call me a good time fella. I ain't black and I ain't a yellow, just a white boy looking for a place to do my thing. Here I don't want no handout living and don't want a part of anything they're giving. I'm proud and white and I got a song to sing. Well, I've said a few things and I'll admit it. If you want to get ahead, you gotta hump and get it. I'm a white boy looking for a place to do my thing. Hump and get it now. Around a little, I like guitars and I like a fiddle, and that's the kind of soul it takes to fan my flame. Well, I'm a blue-eyed Billy, kind of frail and ruddy, so I'll have to work to be somebody. I'm a white boy looking for a place to do my thing. I don't want no handout living and don't want a part of anything they're giving. I'm proud and white and I got a song to sing. Well, I've said a few things and I'll admit it. If you want to get ahead, you gotta hump and get it. I'm a white boy looking for a place to do my thing. I'm a white boy looking for a place to do my thing.